The defense industry report, an executive order mandated last year, is on hold tonight. A Defense Department spokesperson confirmed to Inside Defense the report won't come out this week as anticipated. Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition and Sustainment Ellen Lord says when it does come out, it will look at the department's supply chain, among other topics. Wes Hallman is Vice President of Policy. The National Defense Industrial Association. Corbin Evans is NDIA Director of Regulatory Policy. Gentlemen, thanks very much for coming on. Wes, I'll start with you. What's the genesis of this report? I know the executive order, but what do you think is behind the EO in the first place and what the department wants to learn?
I think what's behind this is that there's a general concern in the defense community that the defense industrial base has been eroding over time. There was a recent report that was done by CSIS that identified that over 11,000 companies had left the defense sector since 2011. And as the administration came in, this topic was of concern, and I think that's what generated the report. And it was to be a holistic look at the entire defense industrial base and how it's serving the nation, how it's serving our national defense.
What's our sense, Corbin, of how the mergers and acquisitions has had an impact on the defense industrial base as well?
Well, it's had a bit of a negative impact in the sense that it has lowered the number of companies available to supply the Defense Department with the tools necessary that it needs to provide tools to the warfighter, and so that's been a negative overall that we've seen. The consolidation in which now we only have one company potentially providing a tool that is necessary for a large machine or some other acquisition necessary for the warfighter.
When this is all happening at the same time, the department over the last several years has made an effort to try to reach out to companies that don't traditionally do business with the Defense Department, and yet 3-4 years into that effort, they still seem to kind of be pushing the rock up the hill, Wes.
Well, it's a, let's face it, the government is a hard customer to work for. That government customer is not just the customer, but they're the regulator and the enforcer. And over the years, the FARs, the federal acquisition regulations, and the Defense Federal Acquisition regulation system has just grown. It's hard to say. It's grown over time, and for companies to comply with that, it's a tough nut to crack. And if you're at a startup with very few, with just one person, or you're trying to grow, to make payroll and to comply with all the rules that it takes to enter that market, and you look at the commercial sector that may have greater returns on investment, it's hard to get into that field. So the department is, and this report is a part of it, is trying to figure out how to bring those innovative companies, as small innovative companies, to refresh the defense industrial base. But it's hard to do over time, and we're seeing that.
Corbin, what do you think is important to watch when this report does come out? Where will be the first places you'll turn?
So I'm going to be interested to see what they have to say about the supply chain. This has been a big focus within the Department of Defense and within the executive order itself, in examining what exactly are the choke points throughout the supply chain for some of our major weapons systems. This creates a situation in which, as I mentioned, we're relying on potentially only one supplier. And sometimes that supplier is located in a country that may not be a friendly, maybe a potential adversary in the future. And so this is something that I really hope that this report examines in detail. And provides the Department of Defense with the means necessary to take steps to avoid these potential choke points in the unfortunate event of a conflict.
And Francis, all I wanted to say was what's really important is, yes, this report is delayed, but the government is moving out. The Defense Department and others within the administration are moving out with various things to try to get after this problem even before this report goes out. I think you can point to the 809 panel, which Corbin knows a lot about, but the conventional arms transfer policy initiatives that are being done in coordination with the State Department, the Department of Defense, Commerce, the CFIUS reforms that we saw out of the Congress and were recently signed into law in the National Defense Authorization Act. So we are getting after this, even though this report has been delayed.
It seems to me, though, there's a chicken or egg issue here when it comes to the supply chain and foreign sources. Is it up to the companies to say, we're not going to source this material from countries that may not be friendly to us, as you alluded to a moment ago, Corbin? Or is it up to the department to say simply, we're not going to buy this stuff anymore and force the companies to go do it? What's the route to success here in that area?
Well, I think companies respond to incentives. And over time, as our greater organic industrial base has shrunk, relatively speaking, there's less and less suppliers within that organic base to supply the defense industrial base, mm-hmm. which of course that we leverage. So if a company has to make, you know, product X, they have to get those components. They're looking out where the components are available. So what we have to do is over time incentivize, like we just talked about, those smaller companies that come back into this sector. Mm-hmm. That also includes workforce challenges that we're facing mm-hmm. across the board, across America. And so you have to have not just the STEM folks, the science, technology, engineering, and mathematics folks, but you also have to have the trades. You have to have these high-tech welders to be able to bend metal for say, the aircraft that mm-hmm. I used to fly.
Corbin, we have about 30 seconds left. Should those incentives be primarily good in that if you do this, good things will happen to you, or more negative, the stick, if you don't do this, this bad thing will happen?
Well, obviously, representing the military industrial base through our organization, we obviously would prefer the carrot. That's something that we see, you know, good incentives can help to foster good business relationships between the government and the private industry.
Corbin, Wes, thanks both very much for joining me. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much.